Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to the channel. Today I'm going to take another topic from English in order to help you for the upcoming NABARD, RBI and SEBI examinations. So English is often ignored by a lot of students and they pay the price in the final mains examination. But I am trying to avoid that from happening, to save you from that happening, with you, through discussion on these topics. I have already provided a total of 22 topics for the upcoming NABARD mains, and I am discussing topics one by one so that you can at least prepare for these 22 topics, and I am very sure that one of them should be asked in the upcoming examination. The topic that we are going to pick up today is called as what steps have been taken to enhance institutional credit in agriculture in India. So we're specifically talking about India. So what steps have been taken to enhance institutional credit in agriculture? First step, as I have mentioned in the past also, is to identify the keywords. What are the keywords here? Enhancement of institutional credit, which is the first keyword, and agriculture being the second keyword here. So what exactly has been already done by the government or by private institutions, let's say, in order to enhance the level of institutional credit availability in Indian agriculture? So in the introduction, you talk about definition of what is an institutional credit, because agriculture definition is not important. So you try and talk about the definition of institutional credit and you bring out a broad advantage or positive feedback or positive impact of enhancement of institutional credit for agriculture in India. That's what we've done here. As in the past videos, I also have told you, define the keyword and then bring out its importance. That actually completes the introduction, makes it simple, and also sends out the right message. So here, the first keyword, institutional credit, what is the definition? Agriculture credit can be broadly grouped into institutional and non-institutional based on source of credit. Non-institutional sources include relatives, money lenders, landlords, traders, etc., etc. On the other hand, institutional sources include RRBs, NABARD, scheduled commercial banks, MFIs, NBFIs, self-help groups, etc., etc. So this way you are sending a message to the examiner, to the reader, that okay, I know what is an institutional credit and how does it differ from a non-institutional source of credit. And that is very important for the examiner to appreciate whatever you have written. And then we talk about the importance. Institutional credit flow has increased in a big way. Government has taken several steps to increase institutional credit flow and to bring out more and more farmers, including SMFs within the institutional credit fold. So this basically, you're spending out some time and some words to mention what are the progress that has already been done, or what are the steps, or if the government has at all focused on institutional credit or not. And then you directly jump to the steps taken, because we have only 300 to 400 words in NABARD, RBI and SEBI examinations. So you don't have a lot of space to explain or to, you know, broaden the horizon and talk about a lot of things in the introduction. So you keep it simple, 50 to 60 words, and then you move to the body paragraph. Now, what do you talk about in the body paragraph? This is a complete RBI kind of an essay, because it talks about all the institutional credit steps that the government or the RBI or these regulatory institutions have taken. So they have to be technical, but at the same time, they have to be simplified so that the examiner can understand it. So priority, let me tell you all the steps. Priority sector lending, institutional subvention scheme, joint liability groups, Kisan credit card. RBI has conveyed, that is to banks, to waive margin or security requirements. So these are the major steps, and then setting up of NABARD, which is an old step which was taken in the 1980s, as well as setting up of regional rural banks, which were also taken in order to enhance institutional credit in India on a broad scale, not only in agriculture. And that's why they're the last steps that have been mentioned here. Okay, so these are the broad steps that we're going to talk about here, and 4 to 5 steps are more than enough. You don't need to chalk out or write down 7-8 steps. You don't need to, also you don't have to limit yourself to 2 or 3 steps, 2 or 3 pointers in your body paragraph. Make it balanced. 4 to 5 is good enough. Priority sector lending. I hope you understand and you know the meaning of priority sector lending, wherein all scheduled commercial banks are required to spend 18% of their net banking credit to agriculture sector, out of which 8% is for small and marginal farmers, so that the marginal small farmers, who are the poorest farmers, are taken out of the shackles of money lending. Okay, under PSL guidelines, a distressed farmer can seek loan to repay the non-institutional lenders also. So this is a very important. Look at the way the government has looked at priority sector lending. They've identified how a distressed farmer is affected, and they've also identified that the only way that a distressed farmer can come out of shackles of money lending is also by paying back that loan in time. And for that also, they're providing this help that under PSL, he or she can actually go to the bank and ask for an institutional credit in order to pay off that non-institutional loan. Second is interest subvention scheme. I hope you know what ISS is already. So herein what happens is, normally the interest rate is 9%, but if you want to take loan through a bank, a farmer can actually do that and pay only 7%, or if he's prompt, he needs to pay only 4% interest. And that is very good. That is incentivizing and promoting him and asking him to go and take a loan from an institutional setup, rather than pay, 40-50% interest on money lending. Although they are simpler to take, it's a lot more harmful because the interest rate is very high. They're very suppressive. Okay. The third one is joint liability groups, wherein banks give out loans to informal groups of 4 to 10 individuals. And the reason that JLGs are very successful is because there is a moral responsibility to pay back the loan in time. And the reason is that it is not an individual who is attached to a loan. Till the time all these 4 to 10 people come together, collude and decide not to pay, the chances of a default are very less. And that is the chances of that happening are also very less, and therefore default rates are also low. And it also encourages community-based village system in India to come together and take loans, together and bring out or come out with something positive in the field of agriculture on a community basis. That was what Mahatma Gandhi also said, that India lies in its villages, and also that we need to further develop the sense of community that we already have, to build upon our strengths and not to, focus only on our weaknesses. So that is something that can be mentioned. Kisan credit card, very important because of the flexibility that it has. It, as mentioned, it was introduced in 1998, and it provides a single window for taking loans on a regular basis. So what happens is, you take a loan from a bank, you are provided with a credit card sort of a thing, wherein you can go to the ATM and take out money whenever you want for a variety of needs, whether you are sowing the seeds and you need money in terms of working capital, or whether you are even if you're utilizing that money for non-farming needs, that is also covered. So even if you have non-farming or off-farm needs, that can also be covered. Even if you have consumption needs, that can also be covered, because a lot of farmers are relying completely on the harvest season. They have no money before that, and only after the harvest season they get a lot of money and they can pay back the loan. So they need that money to survive in that lean period from sowing to harvesting. So Kisan credit card realizes that need of the small and marginal farmer and tries to resolve it or try to fulfill it. Okay, you can go through all these steps that have been mentioned in detail. I'll be providing the PDFs also in the description section below, so you can go through these PDFs also. They'll be very helpful for your examination. These points are not limited to only these essays. These points can also be used in various other essays. You never know what kind of essay comes in the examination. Our objective is to try and maximize the chances of whatever we are reading and whatever we are covering to hit in the examination, like what happened last year also in NABARD mains. Whatever topics I gave, one of them came directly in the examination. I shall be discussing PM Kisan also in the near future, because I'm assuming and I'm like hoping that one essay can be directly from PM Kisan. So I shall be discussing it very shortly. in the near future, and please note all these pointers very seriously. Okay. The next one is waiving of margin of security requirements for agriculture loans up to 1 lakh. That basically means no collateral required. What this exactly means is that, let's say you are a farmer and you go to a bank, okay, and you ask for a loan from the bank. The bank says, okay, you want a loan up to 1 lakh, less than or equal to 1 lakh. You have a motorbike. Why don't you, put that as a collateral? The farmer says, okay, I can do it, but that is the only asset I have. I don't want to let go of it and give it to the bank in case in the future I'm not able to repay this loan because agriculture is so unpredictable. I will have to let go of the only asset that I have and that I use for agricultural purposes, for buying, for traveling to and fro on a daily basis. So that kind of fear does not allow the farmer to go to the bank and forces him to go to a money lender. Now that has been taken care of by not requiring any security or arrangements to be made by the farmer. That is a very important step that has been taken. So a lot of good steps have been taken by the government in order to ensure that the people, the farmers, move towards institutional credit. Crop insurance, a lot of people talked about that. We thought about that, but that does not incentivize directly the farmer. The purpose is not to make him go towards institutional credit. The purpose is to reduce his loss, reduce or minimize his loss from the unpredictabilities of agriculture. And therefore, that has not been included here, that has been cut out. The last step is establishment of NABARD and RRBs like organizations, which were focused on the rural areas, focused on agri-centric areas, the purpose being that these areas are also provided with the required institutional infrastructure and availability of enough people who can incentivize, who can promote, who can go and ask the farmers to come to these banks, come to regional rural banks and cooperative banks and take credit, utilize whatever facilities have been provided. Okay, so these kind of steps have already been taken, and that is what the question is simply all about. It just asks you what are the steps that have been taken to enhance institutional credit in agriculture. Some of you might be thinking that should we be discussing what are the steps that can be taken in the future to enhance institutional credit? Yes, that can also be done, but that can be done only in the conclusion. Remember that. Don't spend a lot of space on mentioning something that has not been asked in the essay. Try and focus on what has been asked. What is the central theme or central purpose of the essay? So you can try and mention what steps can be taken in the future to enhance institutional credit for farmers, but that can only be a conclusion for you, not a part of the body paragraph or the main central theme of the essay. Okay, I hope you have understood very well, and try and remember all these pointers. If not in this format, then in any other format, all these pointers and the purpose of the essay or the topic that has been discussed can be asked in the examination. If you did like this video, if you found it useful for your upcoming examination, do subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss out on the important topics that I'm going to discuss in the future. And also press the bell icon so that you get an immediate notification of whatever I discuss. If you're preparing hard for the upcoming NABARD examination, do keep this in mind. Okay, all the very best. Take care. Have a nice day.